All right, cut. All right, that was a nice shot, guys. All right. Oh. Get a phone call. Yeah? Uh-huh. What do you mean we already ran through the budget? I used one explosion. That's not even like... That's free. What do you... How do you run through the budget when... I used something free? So you're telling me I can't do anything, really? I have no budget. No budget to work with. Really? Alright, well, fine then. No more explosions for you then.
Zach Clayton, the astronomy guy. No. Cut. If we can't avoid a free explosion, how are we going to survive with a copyright strike? We can't do this. Just play some other intro. Just not... No, none of this copyrighted music. We don't want a lawsuit.
Sorry, Zach. Zia. And he's playing Minecraft.
Welcome to Zach Clayton, the Astronomy Guy. A TV series dedicated to talking about various astronomy subjects. Today's topic will be all about space oddities. So we're talking about comets, black holes, white holes, quasars, exoplanets, and galactic cannibalism. Yes, galactic cannibalism is a thing. But first, let's check out the all-exclusive, state-of-the-art observatory. But the real kicker of the observatory is the view from inside. Bam. You can't tell me that this window has the best view in the world. Look how nice and clear that view is. It's amazing. It's outstanding. And then you pair that with the state-of-the-art telescope, you're gonna have an amazing time viewing the stars. It's time to talk about galactic cannibalism. I mean, y'all think that, like, human cannibalism is bad? What about if it was on a galactic scale? What if we were being eaten by another galaxy? That actually happens in space, not our solar system, in space. Now, we don't really need to worry because the Andromeda Galaxy is pretty far away from us. So we're not going to be getting eaten anytime soon. But this does happen. And basically, galactic cannibalism is basically whenever two galaxies collide into one another. And it's basically the absorption of one into the other. So when galaxies collide, their gravitational forces reach out like an arm almost and try to pull each other in. Now, normally, the larger galaxy wins because obviously he's got more power. And he causes distortion to the smaller galaxy, kind of like absorbs some of it into his galaxy now or its galaxy. There's no real... But also, galactic collisions can also create new stars. See, when the galactic clouds found in galaxies collide into one another, new stars are being made through that. So that's pretty cool. So it's not all bad. I don't want to say cannibalism is not bad, because most of the time it is, especially human cannibalism is pretty bad. But we do get some stars out of galactic cannibalism. Fun fact, did you know that you can actually see the moon during the day sometimes?
Wow!
There's a cat on my tramp. I repeat, there's a cat on my tramp.
Exoplanets. Every star in the sky will generally host at least one planet. These other worlds are called exoplanets. There's a wide range of exoplanets. anything from small rocky planets to large gas giants like Jupiter.
Our nearest star, Proxima Centauri, actually hosts one of these exoplanets. The first exoplanet found was 51 Pegasus B. Currently, the count of confirmed exoplanets is in the 4,000s. Many of these exoplanets have been found by finding shadows. Essentially, astronomers would look for tiny shadows in the light from a star similar to a solar eclipse or a lunar eclipse.
It's time for the main event of today's show, black holes. Two scientists in the 18th century theorized about dark stars, or stars that were so massive that light itself couldn't even escape it. Einstein's theory of relativity eventually came back to these dark stars. A physicist by the name of Karl Schwarzschild calculated the general relativity's gravitational equation in a very extreme case. In this extreme case, space-time would fold in on itself, creating a singularity, a region with zero volume and infinite density. Nothing could escape this singularity, or black hole.
Black holes.
Astronomers categorize these black holes into two categories, one with stellar mass or supermassive. How have astronomers found these black holes, you may ask? There are a variety of techniques to find black holes. One such way is monitoring the movements of various stars around a suspected black hole. Utilizing X-ray detectors, scientists have spotted random sources of X-rays in space. These X-rays are due to the black hole stealing hot gas from the star. The friction from this pull generates the X-rays.
Time to learn more about astronomy.
Astronomers collect data using the visible star's spectral emission. While the star moves away from Earth, the emission slides to the blue end. Using this, astronomers can find the speed of stars and then the mass of an object it's orbiting around.
Time to learn more about black holes.
The strongest evidence of black holes existing is found in our own galaxy. From studying the center of the Milky Way, astronomers Reinhard Genzel and Max Planck have found evidence to believe that there is a black hole at the center of the Milky Way. It's time for a little bit about white holes. A white hole is a theory. No one has ever found a white hole in space. However, a white hole is basically the opposite of a black hole. A white hole pushes items out rather than pulling. White holes seemingly can't exist, however, in space, as once a tiny particle enters the part of space-time, with it, the white hole would just dissipate and disappear. So, they're theoretically real, but no one's found one yet, so sadly, they might not be real.
Time to hear from our sponsors.
You'll like the moon? Well, I like the moon too. Come on down to Moon Rock Emporium. We got big rocks,
small rocks,
and rocks. So come on down, touch the moon today. Come on down to Moon Rock Emporium.
Disclaimer, Moon Rock Emporium does not actually own any rocks from the moon. They're just regular rocks.
Quasars are distant objects powered by black holes. Astronomers using radio telescopes found small point source objects that didn't match. These sources were given the name quasars as their signal came from one place. Quasars are the brightest and farthest objects in the early universe. Quasars are only found within supermassive black holes. Some signals break free from the black hole at the edges, and some of the particles accelerate close to the speed of light. Now, this acceleration streaming away in jets above and below, making it visible to the human eye.
Many of the 2,000 known quasars exist in the early life of the galaxy. Quasars can emit energy up to trillions of electronic volts. These quasars can shine upwards 100,000 times brighter than the Milky Way. Quasars are an important aspect of understanding the Big Bang and the early universe.
In ancient times, comets were objects that generally frightened the population. In current society, however, they are studied and observed as the bringers of life to Earth. Comets likely come from a vast storehouse of comets, nearing the 100 billion. These comets come from the icy outreaches far beyond the planets. This orbit of comets around our solar system is called the Kuiper Belt. Comets have been found to be made up of various gases: cyanogen, carbon, carbon monoxide, nitrogen hydroxyl, and nitrogen hydride, respectively. Recently, scientists have found oxygen in comet 67P, and that it was the fourth most prevalent gas in the comet's halo. This oxygen had been believed to be in the comet since some 4.6 billion years ago, and had stayed around ever since. Evan Haley utilized Newton's law of gravitation and concluded that they follow the law as well. Haley predicted the arrival of the comet later, and he was correct. The comet was then named Halley's Comet, because, I mean, he, you know, after Edmund Halley. The first to ever record comet in 467 BC was Halley's Comet. All regular returning comets move in an elliptical pattern, similar to the planets around the sun. Other stray comets move in parabolas.
Are you tired of playing soccer? You can throw out that old thing and get the moon ball. You can throw it. You can bounce with it. And you can throw it at your friends. It will also take you to the moon.
Extraterrestrials, I mean, yeah, they're a phenomenon in the science fiction world and, you know, aliens and all that, but extraterrestrials are intelligent life forms that would be found in space. Currently, there has been no evidence that they exist. However, there are many suitable planets for intelligent life to live on. The question is, how would we communicate with these life forms? For starters, we could estimate that the average distance between these civilizations would be about 100 light years or so. Therefore, any two-way communication would take around 200 years to receive, assuming our signals are sending at the speed of light. An obvious way to find extraterrestrials would be to travel out there ourselves and visit the planets. Currently, this task seems impossible, as even the fastest space probes still take around 50,000 years just to make it to Alpha Centauri. Assuming the 100 light year difference, we'd be looking at 600,000 years or the entire lifetime of our species to go get there. So for space travel to be practical, we'd have to up our ships to at least travel at the speed of light, something that's not possible in today's society as of right now. Scientists have actually sent probes out into our solar system with paper containing the universal language of mathematics in an attempt to get them to unravel where the probes came from. Well, that about wraps up Zach Clayton, the Astronomy Guys show today, so I hope you guys enjoy, and I'll see you guys next time. Peace. Everybody get up.
up, it's time to slam now. We got the real jam going down. Welcome to the Space Jam. Space Jam. Here's your chance, do your dance at the Space Jam. Alright.
There's a cat on a lane and a cat on a lane. A cat on a lane and a cat on a lane. Cat on a lane, cat on a lane. Cat on a lane, cat on a lane.
There's a boo. Call it. What wakes me up at 3 in the morning?
She got excited over it.
Oh, you're right on my paper. Move.
Move it on the other side.
Get off.
The funny thing is, I'm still recording. Bad paper.
Hey, you're a rock. No! Nine! Stop moving! Stick.
Where's another stick?
That's not
science. Not science. Astronomy. Read you that.
Wait. No.
Looper. I like pie. You like pie. I like pies. You like pies. I like rocks. You like rocks. I like rocks. You do too. Come on, come on. I like moon rocks, meteors, and astronomy. That's been with me. This whole pavement made out of moon rocks. Literally.
That was so dumb. You had it.